In 1968, there were fewer than 350 annulments in America. Total, 350. By 1989, there were over 70,000 annulments in America, which says that 144,000 people had their marriages annulled in one calendar year. Henry, through all of the workings of him trying to get his annulment and then, you know, the divorce, he was putting the state in power. So in effect, what happened there was is that he put his church over the Catholic Church. And essentially, England was lost for want of an annulment.
Mm-hmm.
And Luther recommended the death penalty for adulterers. He says, when one resists the other and refuses the conjugal duty, she is robbing the other of the body she had bestowed upon him. For this reason, the civil government must compel the wife or put her to death. This is the direct quote.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. Welcome to today's episode of the Dr. J Show. My guest today is John Francis Clark. John Clark has been married to his wife, Lisa, for 30 years and is the father of 9 children. He's an online course developer for Seton Home Study School. He's a political speechwriter and a regular columnist for the National Catholic Register. He's written a very interesting book called Betrayed Without a Kiss, Defending Marriage After Years of Failed Leadership in the Church. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. John Francis Clark, thanks so much for being my guest today.
Thanks for having me. It's an honor to be on your show. I love the work you're doing, so thank you very much.
Oh, well, it's a pleasure to meet you face to face. I feel like we've had several long phone conversations, and
yes,
and we have many things in common, including that we are both from Columbus, Ohio, and I went to
yes.
the Ohio State University.
The, yes, that's right. Very good.
O-H-I-O. There you go. Okay, very good. So anyway, you've written this lovely book, really a very lyrical book, called Betrayed Without a Kiss, Defending Marriage After Years of Failed Leadership in the Church. And I've seen mm-hmm. many of your, I would say, columns in the Register, of course, and then some of the things that you've written on Facebook have been really, very thought-provoking and inspiring. And I know a lot of your friends are fascinated by what you're saying. What prompted you to write this particular book, John?
So, a few years ago, a friend of mine was going through a divorce, it sort of prompted me to, and this was happening, we all have Catholic friends that are going through divorces. I think we all do. I think that's probably fair to say. And it really caused me to start looking into where the church stood on things, because he would mention something to me and think, that can't be right. It doesn't sound right to me. And he would mention something else and I'd think about the same response. And it sort of started me down the process of investigating both civil law and canon law. So one of the things that I discovered is the more you go down this road about how the church has treated matrimony, the more disturbing it gets. So I had never been in that situation before. I mean, as I've mentioned, I always say that I have had a storybook marriage. We've been married 30 years. I married my, quote, dream girl. I have 9 children. Divorce would be the furthest thing from my mind. But as I started looking into this for friends, I discovered some things that were not very good at all. For one thing, one of the things that he said that shocked me, and I wasn't aware of this, is that in every diocese in America, I believe it is every diocese, there is a mandate to civil divorce prior to having an annulment hearing. To me, that's pretty shocking. I thought, how could it be that for the Roman Catholic Church to have a hearing about whether a marriage is valid, it is essentially waiting for the approval of the state.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that's not good. And it's funny because we often hear the terms of, you know, separation of church and state. What about the separation of sacrament and state? I'm not really sure why one would be related to the other. And that sort of, you know, that bothered me.
My immediate response to that is that the church, it's not separation of church and state, it's subordination of the church to the state. And it sounds like it's voluntary subordination of the church to the state. Exactly. They wouldn't have to have that policy. So, yeah, okay, yes. I get you. This is disturbing. Yeah, tell us more.
Exactly. And I think I would say it like this, just to stay on the sacramental path, and I'm going to talk about this a little bit too, is that there is a denial of matrimony as a sacrament. That's what's going on in the church right now. And when I say the church, I have to be really careful in terms of my terms. When I say the church, I'm speaking about officials, some officials in the church. I'm not saying the church, right? I'm not saying the, extraordinary magisterium, right? But one of the problems that when I was doing a lot of this research, this was occurring at a time when churches were closed and people weren't getting anointing of the sick. People weren't getting confession. People weren't getting baptism. I had some friends overseas who waited, I believe, 1 year to have their baby baptized because the priests were afraid to, after all, there was COVID, whatever that happened to mean. Right. So.
Oh my gosh.
So I So that is why that I in the register, which you and I both write for happily, I pointed some of these things out, and I thought, what is it that we believe? What do we are the sacraments necessary? Everything I've ever read in the history of the church has said yes. And yet, so matrimony seemed to be, there seemed to be some significant problems with how church officials were treating matrimony. But also, as I say, the Eucharist, which people probably certainly couldn't receive for at least a few weeks during COVID, you couldn't receive the Eucharist. You were promised with all the sacraments. So it's a big problem. And the more that I research, the more you've probably seen these numbers too. I looked into the annulment process. I think annulments is something that a lot of Catholics are wondering sort of what's going on. I see some numbers, I hear things. I haven't been to it. Most Catholics have not been to our marriage tribunal, but they're asking what's going on? Well, the numbers that I ran across in 1968, there were fewer than 350 annulments in America, total 350. So let's remember that number. 1968, there were fewer than 350 annulments in America. By 1989, there were over 70,000 annulments in America. I believe the number is 72,000 in that year, which says what? Which says that 144,000 people had their marriages annulled in one calendar year.
Let's take a step back and look at historically what's going on, what's been going on and so on. And I want to start, I cannot let you get away without talking about the opening chapter of your book, which is very historical. You go all the way back to Adam and Eve, that's going back to the origins of things. You had a very, it was very moving the way you described the very first marriage in the beginning, you call it from Eden to Canaan. So, John, tell us about the first marriage. What happened? And then what went wrong?
Well, I think a fascinating part of it is, and when you delve into Genesis and the Genesis commentaries, it's incredibly rich. It's an inexhaustible richness that we have in Genesis. The trick is things happen so fast, right? So just in a few verses, Adam was there. A few verses later, they fell. So what I wanted to find out if you want to try to figure out how God intended marriage, it's very natural to go back to the book of Genesis, right? This was my thinking. So what's interesting to me is that Adam is created. He's put in the garden. Now remember, this is in a pre-fallen world, right? He looks around and he feels incomplete. That to me is pretty fascinating, right? In other words, the world is as good as it can be, right? Basically, right? It's not fallen. We can't even really imagine what it would be like.
Right.
So he feels that he knows it is incomplete, and he senses that humanity is incomplete. So of course, what happens next is that he falls into it. God puts him into a deep sleep. One of his ribs, God forms Eve. He wakes up and now he feels complete. there's a certain theology of marriage there that we gloss over far too quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Because that sense of incompleteness, I think people do feel today. I don't think that that's unique in a sense. I think people feel the need to be married. I mean, this is sort of put within our hearts, right? What's interesting about there's, I shouldn't say what's interesting because there are 1,000 things that are interesting in the book of Genesis in terms of just a few verses. But one thing I find interesting, I hadn't seen anybody exactly phrase it this way, is that Adam is one flesh who becomes two, in a sense. With the using his rib, Adam is one flesh and becomes two. Then they are married and they become one again.
Mm-hmm.
It's fascinating. This all happens really fast. So obviously with the, and so they're given a command, be fruitful and multiply. So I'm gonna talk about that a little bit too, about children. That's probably one of the things that struck you in the chapter, reading it through. So the idea that to be fruitful and multiply, we can see that children are the primary purpose of marriage from the beginning. Now, this is key because obviously today, this doctrine is, people don't like, a lot of times people don't like it.
No, that's very true that they don't like it then. And there was some controversy around Vatican II, whether this is the primary or whether we have two that are co-equal, the good of the spouses and the procreation of children, that are those co-equal or is one primary? And when I read this, what jumped out at me was the fact that we've had for, 50 years, my entire adult life, really, we've had people saying there are too many people on the planet. And so therefore, the whole idea of being fruitful and multiply is now something we're all supposed to reflexively be suspicious about. And yet there it is in the scripture. We can't imagine that this is optional somehow, that somehow we modern people have gone beyond that. We don't need to even consider it anymore. But anyway, and also it's fascinating that when Adam and Eve get kicked out of the garden, there aren't any babies yet. It's just Adam and Eve.
Correct.
Right.
By the way,
anyway, continue.
No, I was just going to say, by the way, just as a quick aside, I was going to say that I loved your piece in the Register. Oh, thank you. I appreciate that.
Your publisher, our mutual publisher, will also appreciate it. This is the book.
Yes.
Okay. Sorry. Go ahead, John. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say that I really appreciated your article in the Register, welcoming the 8 billionth baby. And I thought, this is great.
This is
terrific. No, it was fantastic. I love that. I think it was great. I read it at least once. I was like, this is exact. No, it was great. But so Adam and Eve are designed to have babies, right? That's fairly clear. I mean, that's it. And that's in a way sort of the tragedy. So when you read Genesis, I'm not trying to say this in a funny way, but it's more of an ironic one, that the fathers seem to think that Adam and Eve fell on the first day. They were there long enough to basically to have a cup of coffee and they fell. So it was very sad. But the point is, yeah, right. So, but the point is that they were designed to have babies. So the idea that the primary purpose of marriage is found right in Genesis. It's right there. The other part of it too, that I think struck me as I went through and really delved into the Genesis commentaries is this. So Adam and Eve went through the most tumultuous few, I mean, it started right away. They went through the most tumultuous marriage ever, I would think. I mean, the world fell. So we went from a pre-fallen state, the Garden of Eden, to the world is now fallen. Basically, things are collapsing around them. The devil thinks he's won. Now, the devil, it is clear from the text that the devil, so marriage is structured in Genesis as a triangular relationship, I would call it. It is not a union between a man and wife only. It's a triangular relationship among a man, a woman, and God.
Mm-hmm.
That is how marriage is structured. So when the devil comes in the form of a serpent, comes in and tempts Adam and Eve, and they're both together. Sometimes the narrative is told that, well, Eve was there, but Adam kind of came later. No, they were together. And I actually look back in the Hebrew, and this is fairly clear from the Hebrew, is that Adam and Eve were there together. Well, they both fell together. So it tells you mm-hmm. what? It tells you that the serpent was trying to attack a marriage. And in doing so, The couple didn't seem to want to divorce each other. After all, Adam supported Eve even in her sin, right? Who did they want to divorce? They wanted to divorce God.
Right. And that was the devil's ultimate target, was to separate them from God.
That's exactly it. And so really, wow, what is the devil doing right away? The devil right away is trying to break up a marriage. Well, I mean, you know, you fast forward to today, well, not a lot has changed. The devil's temptations tend to have a certain similarity to it, right?
Yes.
But the devil, yes, thinks he has won. I would imagine that the devil thought that, well, what happens next is obvious. They're going to go to hell. Marriage is destroyed. This whole thing of, you know, this creation thing, this didn't work out. Only God views this and has mercy toward Adam and Eve and speaks harshly. I don't think that's right, but he speaks harshly to the devil. You've done this. So what will happen next? The woman will crush your head. So he goes from thinking, hey, I won. Marriage is wrecked. Creation didn't work out. This whole thing about marriage will never work. What I find interesting is this. Among the interesting things that happened in the garden, what's interesting to me is that Adam and Eve never got divorced. They had the most tumultuous marriage ever. You can't top it, right? And they never seemed to even consider divorce. And in my book, I say, maybe it's because they always remembered how happy marriage could be.
Wow, John. Yeah. And they had to face the devil face to face. And we don't. We don't face him face to face in quite the immediate way that they did. And still, they didn't get divorced. That's really interesting, John.
Well, that's exactly right. And I think that that's what stood out to me. If you spend time on those verses, it's really fascinating. And, you know, and we know that, you know, God hates divorce because he tells us. We have that on the authority of God in the book of Malachi. Right. So we have that on the authority of God himself.
Right, right.
The other thing that strikes me in those passages is that children are the primary purpose of marriage, but marriage is also indissoluble from the beginning. Well, how do we know? We have it on the authority of Jesus, because in the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus says God allowed divorce for the hardness of hearts. But in the beginning, it was not so.
In the beginning, right, right.
In the beginning. And again, if you want to understand matrimony, let's start at the beginning. And so already in just a few verses, we're seeing the primary purpose described for us very clearly. We're seeing that's indissoluble from the beginning.
Right.
And so we have to remember, too, that marriage, that the sacraments are restorative. God is restoring something there, right? What is he restoring? Well, in the New Testament, when Jesus institutes the sacraments, he is restoring marriage.
You know, Ruthie's, I think you can see already the depth and the riches of this book. Okay, so you're really going to need to get this book and read the whole thing and meditate on it. And you should probably follow John in the National Catholic Register, too, because a lot of his columns are very interesting on this very sort of topic. But I want to turn now, we went all the way back to the beginning, but we got to fast forward a little bit because we'll be here all day. and that is, you start talking about some of the political, social and political things that took place to get us to where we are today. Let's move forward to around the year 1500 let's talk about what the Reformation brought to the understanding of marriage and matrimony and that has led us to the very secularized position that we're in today.
Okay, so that's a great question. So Constantine, in 313, with the Edict of Milan, his main focus was return. Well, obviously, Christianity was made the religion of the state, which was good. Constantine put the church essentially in charge of marriage.
Okay.
1,200 years go by, all right, because you want to get to 1500. So essentially what happened there I can't give a full biography of Henry VIII, but I think most people are familiar with the story that Henry VIII was married to his wife, Catherine of Aragon. So Henry VIII initially wanted an annulment, but he wanted to marry Anne Boleyn, fell in love with her. Now, Henry was a philanderer. Everybody kind of knew that. Maybe 5 years into the marriage, I think the first evidence that he had cheated on Catherine was about 5 years in. But Henry, through all of the workings of him trying to get his annulment and then, you know, the divorce, he essentially, what happened in effect with all of that was, is that he was putting the state in power, because he was basically saying, and as well as the church also, right? So Henry made his subjects sign the oath, you know, the Acts of Supremacy, which basically Henry was asking the faithful Catholics in England to do two things. One, deny the primacy of Peter, right? In other words, deny the Pope. That was one. Because why? Well, because the Pope said you can't get an annulment, right? So Henry wanted to say, no, you have to sign this saying that, you know, you deny the Pope, or the Pope's authority in England, at least, right? The second was he made them affirm that his marriage to Anne Boleyn was valid. He made them, imagine that. Why did he care? He cared a lot, as it turns out. He cared plenty. So in effect, what happened there was, is that he put his church over the Catholic Church. And essentially, England was lost for want of an annulment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so now let's see how that lines up with Luther and what Luther was doing and saying about matrimony and marriage and the relation between the state and the church in this area.
Right, so essentially, it's the key point there too is that Clement VII lost England to save a marriage. And I think that now he had no choice in a sense. He couldn't find a valid marriage at all. But anyway, that's the key. So in terms of Luther.
But wait a minute. That's an important, you toss that off like it was an offhand comment. but what it shows mm-hmm. is how seriously everybody took the law of marriage. You know, that marriage was subject to divine law. If Pope Clement VII had been a real politique kind of guy who was just maximizing mm-hmm. his power, that would have been a stupid thing to do. He didn't do that. You know, that's not what he did. He was willing to allow all of the geopolitical consequences, which were enormous, and he surely knew that. He was willing to endure all of that to safeguard what he believed at the time to be the correct definition and understanding of marriage, right? So that, is that, am I putting words in your mouth, or is that
no,
what
that's
you mean?
Nope, not at all. That's exactly correct. And he knew that England would be lost. And the reason he knew that was, and this is, I have a long section in this. I don't know if we have much time to go into this, but this is why Bishop John Fisher died. Okay. There were, in other words, a number of people were martyred because they refused to affirm the marriage of Henry and Anne Boleyn. People were murdered for not signing along to that belief. So you're talking about everybody from the common people to Bishop John Fisher to Thomas More. I mean, people died in defense of matrimony. And I think that in that chapter, I talk about the fact that that was not uncommon. Many people died. So matrimony is to me, it's the primordial sacrament. You don't have sacraments without matrimony. What else do you have? You need to have children, right? So in any case, I think that is key. In terms of Luther, there's a few aspects.
So
I
hold on, hold on. Let me hold on, hold on. Let me finish. Let me wrap that up. And then we're going to go to Luther for sure. But look, people died defending the proper view of matrimony, and we're afraid of having people be mean to us in a conversation. I mean, Catholics, Christians mm-hmm. of all stripes, please let's get this in perspective, okay? That's how important God's plan for marriage really is, and our ancestors died to give us this. And so the least we can do is endure a little bit of ridicule. Okay, but now let's go ahead and talk about Luther. And this will probably be a little controversial because we have many Lutheran followers amongst the Ruth Institute, because among our friends in the Missouri Synod branch of Lutheranism, those people are pro-marriage, and mm-hmm. they're appalled at many of the things that are happening in society and within their own denomination a lot of times, you know. And so we've got Lutheran followers amongst our Ruth Institute friends, but we need to tell the truth about what really happened with Luther. What was Luther's view about the proper role of matrimony in society and its relation to the church and state?
So there are a few key points I would just go over briefly. The first one is that he Luther denied that marriage was a sacrament. He essentially argued that St. Jerome had mistranslated, and that was the problem. So marriage, he thought marriage was not a sacrament. It was a civil contract. So he regarded it as something of the state primarily. Okay, that's key, because that logic will come up later. He denied that marriage demanded fidelity, but that sort of understates things. And I'm going to read you a quick quote. It's pretty brief. Luther writes, "One finds many a stubborn wife like that who will not give in." He's talking about sexual relations, who will not give in and who cares not a whit whether her husband falls into the sin of unchastity 10 times over. Here it is time for the husband to say, if you will not, another will. The maid will come if the wife will not. Now, you're talking about a major religious leader. It's the rare religious leader who recommends sex with a maid. I'm not trying to be funny. I'm just simply saying that this was his position. Thirdly, he denied
that
marriage
was... Was he being ironic? Was he saying that for effect to goad women into doing their wifely duty, or what's the context here?
His position was the state should step in if the wife denies her husband. Dramatically, so he also believed that marriage was indissoluble. He denied that marriage was indissoluble. He believed that if a wife refused at any point to have relations with her husband, that dissolves the marriage, quote, dissolves the marriage.
Really?
Okay.
Really?
Yes.
So automatically, do you need a finding of fact or anything like that? Or what?
No, he didn't seem to think so. I would phrase it this way. I would say that Luther called for what we might term a hostile takeover of marriage by the state. And I don't really think there's any other way to put it. Remember I talked about Constantine giving the church power over marriage. Luther wanted it back. I'll give you another quote from him. He says, when one resists the other and refuses the conjugal duty, she is robbing the other of the body she had bestowed upon him. For this reason, the civil government must compel the wife or put her to death. This is a direct quote. So in terms of when did the state get power? By the way, there were, as you well know, there were Lutheran states. There were essentially countries organized under the Lutheran faith, religion, and they took it seriously.
So it's Luther's idea that marriage should be a state institution, not a church institution. What's the immediate and long-term consequence of that? Let's tease out the consequence of that, not only in Lutheran confessional states, but in mm-hmm. Catholic states and in the secular world that we have today that is not a confessional state of any sort. How does that, give us a few links in that chain from
right, so,
Luther to today. Yeah.
So I would say that it introduced the idea into the faithful that the state should have some authority over the sacraments, right?
Okay, fair enough.
And I think that basically set the stage for what was to follow. And as it turns out, if you actually wanted to look back and say, this is why I have the section devoted to this question, because people say, when did this start happening? And I think that's reasonably why. As soon as you say the state should be in charge of matrimony, then you ask another six questions, beginning with, well, should the state have authority over baptism? You know, again, we have to look at what people said and did. And I think it is not in the service of truth to just ignore a lot of what Luther said, because you have to ignore a lot. So anyway,
yes,
the idea.
Yes, yes. So what we're going to do now, something a little different we've never done before, Ruth Institute followers, and that is that we're going to wrap up the first part of this interview with John Francis Clark and his marvelous book, Betrayed Without a Kiss. You can find the conclusion to this interview on the Ruth Institute Locals channel. We're going to be discussing these most controversial points over there. Now, you think it's controversial here? Now we're going to be talking about the problems in the Catholic Church, which are Legion, unbelievable. Okay. Well, we're going to do it over on Locals Channel because that's a free speech platform. And they'll actually allow us to speak like mature, intelligent citizens of a free country. They won't take down our videos. They won't put stupid warning labels on our videos. So go on over there. If you don't already have an account over there, just sign up for a free account and I'll see you soon right over there. Before we go though, John, tell people one last time, what's the name of your book and where can they get your book?
Thank you. So the book is released the day before All Saints, and it is October 31st, and they can go to tanbooks.com to pre-order right now. And please buy one for your priest. Buy one for yourself and one for your parish priest.
See you over at Locals.